So let's talk about your poetry. I mean, don't you think that basically this kind of look is already an after nuclear war? You know what I mean? It's like, looks like your idea of evolution is an involution. Looks like your idea of contemporary belongs to the past. Or anyways, you know, sometimes this kind of look is be old, passé. I mean, sometimes you say in interviews that Jean Prouvaire is someone you really like and you get inspired, even if you knew him on the way of your career. But do you think that Jean Prouvaire would approve of that?
I hope. I don't know.
No, but seriously.
But if you feel yourself like a soulmate or something, you think it's the other way around also.
But he was really, sure. But he was really making an effort in order to testify his own time. Do you believe that this testifies your time? I mean,
I
you have
so.
Such a filter to your vision. I mean, really, you think that layer, I mean, really, it's after, looks like the Noah's Arch, you know? We have been after the Diluvio, after the
yeah,
Diluvio, you know
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
This is your aesthetic, you feel like that?
Well, what I feel about my aesthetic is that that is apart from that it's practical. And but the thing you said, I think a very strong historical feeling. So if I thought about it a long time, but at a certain moment I thought I always design what is natural, what feels quite as if it has been always there, but still is new. So I don't know where it comes from, but so there's an idea, and then it's really finished, and everybody thinks, yes, this is quite normal. But in fact, it's quite new in its approach, the materials are new, the way it's made. But in the end, it's like a reflection of, I always say everybody has the same information, because we get so much information by television, by the newspapers, and everybody knows more or less the same in general. But if you abstract ideas from it, if it communicates, it's because you have a certain amount of information for you, even in Italy. If we go to China for the first time, it's almost as if we know the world, because we know so much. And I think I'm taking the things out of the garbage can of history of what's happening in our life. That's what I hope. You know?
And that's probably why your aesthetic is so different from all the rest of the Dutch front, in a way. No, I mean, for example, how do you relate with an aesthetic like the one of Mooi?
No, Mooi is a compilation of a lot of Dutch designers. Of
yeah,
course.
But there is a clear vision. I mean, it's very, you know, very glossy, let's say.
Yeah,
right?
Well, what we do is not, even if it shines, it's not glossy. So, but that's. I think they are very much into the design market and focused on that market, and we're more or less the aside. So every current has its countercurrent. You know, if everybody walks that direction and you go that direction, there's space for it. So, and I'm very much always doing the opposite of what the rest of the world is trying to do, because I dislike, you know, if three people go in that direction, I choose the other direction. I really dislike doing.
You choose
the
to walk in the wood and to pick up pieces of wood and to go back home.
Well, the whole scrapbook thing is in fact, it's two things. It's that I always look at materials and techniques, and so I see the quality of a material much earlier than other people, because I love materials. I think they are worth the fortune, you know. Every material has its value, and we do as if we are valuable, and we forget that the material itself is quite valuable. But the other thing is that those tables, that they are the opposite of what you normally do. So normally
you try to work less as possible in order to make the pieces to cost very little here. The components cost very little, but there is a lot of work, and you want to show it.
Yeah, in fact, it's what's happening now. You know, mankind is increasing dramatically, and sources are decreasing dramatically.
So we have to use the labor.
It's the future. It's the future that we have to be much more aware of the lack of materials.
In fact, I was reading an interview of you, and you were saying it's much better to do something like this, because there is a. This is something that people buy and will probably give to their children and to their grandchildren.
Yeah,
if you buy an IKEA that is certificated, whatever, but then you throw it out after 2 years, what is ecology? That's what Pete says. Yeah, in a way I agree. But
best thing to do both.
Best thing to do both, to combine the two things.
Yeah, to have something which is a proper wood and last long. But proper wood which you throw away fast, it's not good either. So.
Yeah, but then, I mean, if ecology is your main focus,
but
then...
It's not my main focus. I think it's a normal thing.
It's a normal thing, I mean, why do you arrive then to pieces like these that are almost aesthetically the opposite than these? You know what I mean? It's like these very refined, these would be non-conventional. You know what I mean? It's so refined, and I mean, how can you combine these two completely different aesthetics?
Well, for me, it's very much the same, because this is a born because of the idea to do something with this material. So I'm always inspired by material. So it's scrap wood at that moment, and it might be shiny metal on another moment, or leather, or I always try to do something which is a combination of those things.
So you find a relation between the two.
Yeah, but for example, this chair, which was the reason for the re-edition, this chair has one trick, that there is a rubber thing in it, and the leather is pulled on the corner, and then it's attached, so the leather and the metal is attached by a leather thing here, which is quite a simple way to do it, and that was the reason to make this whole design. But with the scrap wood, I saw the scrap wood and had the idea to do something with it, and that was the basis for that design. So it's always a combination of material and technique and craftsmanship which gives the inspiration for a product. So in that sense, it's all the same. I can tell for every product a little story how I came to it. So for me, that's the basic thing.
If you could choose today, I mean, what would you write in memory of Pete? You know what I mean? A sentence that really gives a sense to your whole life. I mean, something that really, in a way, synthesizes your poetry.
Well, I've thought about it a lot. I always say, if you want to change the world, it's quite strange to make tables and chairs. So because it's quite a stupid thing.
So why you do that?
I make it because I love to create. I love to make stuff. You know, I made from very little. I made little. I always been busy making things with my hands and with my head. So it's something which is in my nature. But if I think, and I also would like to change the world into a better world, but the profession is not the best profession to do it. So it's a difficult question.
You still can choose, you know, if you want to turn into...
The funny thing is, in the end, is that you get a lot of interviews, in fact, a lot of people see your products and understand them or not, but at least you have quite an influence with the work, because it's a profession which is enormously covered by publicity and so on, which gives the opportunity to at least say what you want about the things, how you think it should go.
Could it be just do and don't think?
I think a lot.
Or you think a lot?
I think a lot, yeah. I think all the time.
So you thought that Lazy Laces is a manifesto for you?
No,
before I was telling him, why don't you close your laces? And he was saying, no, they are lazy laces.
Yeah, but that's because I do it all the time.
No, but you know, that could be part of your field. I think that tells a lot about the personality, you know what I mean? Lazy laces. I mean, looks like informal, but it's very, it's a real statement, aesthetically. Anyway, something you want to add for our viewers?
Well, I'm always happy to be here at Rosanna's place because I never like to travel, but the first time I came to Milan because Rosanna invited me, and I really loved it because it's here, it's Italian, you know. If you come 3 weeks later, it's still like this.
Pete, only one question I forgot. You still live in Eindhoven, very close actually.
Yeah.
You think that the environment helps you a lot in your poetic? I mean, helps you a lot in doing the things you do?
No.
Not at all?
No, not at all.
You could be anywhere?
Yeah, even in the forest. I even had people who saying that's not possible and started almost quarreling with me, saying that it should be an inspiring environment.
It's not
but
at all.
But if I'm in a forest or in a...
I mean, you could be in Minnesota. You could be anywhere in the world.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it doesn't matter where I am. I have too many ideas. Probably you have also.
Probably the things that really are important to you the same as are important to me is your wife and your three
the
daughters.
Children.
That's really the yeah, they are.
That's the main point.
Good, Pete. That's the best.
Okay.
Ciao, amen. Bravo.